floaty. I wear the Scuba Pro jet fins and they're rubber and they sink. So I really felt in control of what I was doing with the camera. I could ballast myself with a heavy rubber fin better than with our Big Sea Wing Nova. So that little stuff like that, I noticed, and I didn't go back after the second day. I did not wear any other fins but my heavy rubber fins. And you can see I'm holding myself with my feet out with my rubber fins. And then I'm like, okay, don't blow it, you know? And then I got that shot. So I love it. And I said, how? About right there is getting a picture and making somebody's, you know, trip for sure. Now this one I put up here because I kind of blew it here. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about the camera and what I learned and how quickly the learning curve is. And I highly suggest not learning underwater, but when you're on the boat, start taking pictures. Get somebody to run past you, get like, you know, try to mess with the camera when you're at home. I thought I only am gonna mess with the camera on a dive because that's what I'm gonna be doing. You learn so much on land, in the housing and messing with it. So what I learned with this camera, so I'm just gonna step over here and show you guys. On this camera, everything on here, it's a full manual camera. So I have shot some pictures. I shoot with a Minolta SRT 101, which was made before I was born, I think, or right around when I was born. And I shoot with black and white film. So I know a little bit about shutter speed and aperture and that stuff. Not, I mean, I get it, but it has a little circle in there. When the thing goes in the middle, I know that's when I can take my picture. So when I went down with this and I saw that it has full manual, I go, well, I'm not quite ready for that, full manual. But then when it said it has aperture priority and shutter priority, so what would that mean? So the shutter priority, if I'm doing shutter priority, it's gonna select the aperture for me and I'm gonna select my shutter. So when a manta's going by, I can go really slow. I can go 1/400, especially when he's a poser like that black one was. And if wahoo are going by, you need 1/2000s, you know? So it has to be much faster. And I wasn't fast enough or thinking fast enough to get these guys in focus. Now I know, and I will get wahoo next time. Mm. You know, but so shutter priority for deep open water pictures. And I would think, I haven't done it yet, but aperture priority for macro stuff. Because then you're picking how big the lens, how much space you have to open the lens, okay? So aperture priority for macro, shutter priority for blue water diving. So such a huge, it made, as soon as I picked shutter priority, I got all those good shots, okay? So it simplified it enough for me to be able to use partial manual, half manual, okay? And then, but then don't worry about that. It has a little guy right there that has a fish on it. And that means, okay, the camera's gonna try to guess everything you want, okay? And what I found is it takes great pictures. Like when I was in Cozumel, that's all I used and I got good pictures, but not these kind, you know, the good pictures. So you start out with it trying to guess what you're doing and figure everything out in good viz, and then start messing around with it. That's half the fun of it. At first, I just wanted to take great pictures right off. And so once I learned and went through and started doing this stuff, I just adored it. Loved it. So let's see what else we got here. Yeah, she had a camouflage suit on that kind of popped with the white. The white helped bring out the bubbles and the white on her suit and the white on that manta. I think that's I mean, you can see how much detail is on this guy. It's just picking up everything. That's this. This is a little pocket camera. It's awesome. Okay, now this is a, this, I wish I had, do I have the other one? I don't. Okay, so, hang on. I think I blew it. Okay, so this one, when I got back up on the boat and I saw this picture, I didn't see anything. All I saw was washed out blue, okay? So I had my computer, all I saw was blue, and I saw this and this a little bit, and her fins, and I go, then I tried the $99 Photoshop, not pro, but the $99 one, and turned it black and white, because I was, this trip just really, I'm always the last one, I always have the most air, but I did it this time because I was so excited trying to learn how to use my camera. But I was about 50 feet away from her, and she was down deeper than me, and because this is kind of stretched in, but so when I put it on my Photoshop and I turned it black and white and I was able to do the contrast, I got this shot, which I think it's actually amazing. Obviously, you can see that there's some scatter and stuff like that, but it's it was literally just a blue picture. So don't give up on yourself. Definitely listen to these guys when they talk about pulling the picture out of the blue, because that's kind of, I mean, that was a cool moment in her life, and she gets to look back on it now, you know? Okay, this is me, and this was a cool moment in my life, because what this camera got for me was the dive of my life, okay? So this is a big school of fish behind here, and this tuna was about 250 pounds, and he was just going around having snacks, and all these are sharks, and they're doing the same thing. And it's all current, so it's just me kicking to stay underneath it, kicking, and Julie bumped out to the blue and got this shot of me trying to get this tuna, and he was coming within 2 feet of me, just like, whatever, you little thing, you know? And so this is what it looks like with the blue. It's blued out, and then what you can make it pop. So for me, I'm loving it.
Question then.
Yeah, sure. On the tuna one?
No, the last one.
Yes.
The kind of rings that go around the picture, what causes that?
That's one of you guys?
It's just from the sunlight coming through the
water. Yeah, you can start seeing it. Sometimes it'll be raised down like that. And then when you're deeper, the rays turn into, get refracted, I guess, a little bit, and they turn into circles. But it does look, it kind of looks cool.
Yeah, I get it too much.
You do get it too much?
Yeah.
You know what? Go up a little bit. What, do you know what your depth is when you're getting that a lot?
What does cause it sometimes is if your camera is pointed a little bit more downward and it's not catching so much of the sun rays coming through the water. And I'll talk about it more a little bit later, but when you are taking the photographs or videoing underwater, especially in wide open blue like this, you always want it to be a little bit more up if you can. Otherwise, you do get like the rings coming through.
Yeah, and I am shooting down right there,
yeah,
for sure. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Okay, that's my picture. So I'm gonna show you the setup that I used down there. So this little guy, it's got the on button right here, and then a video button and picture button. So it is easier than a DSL in that fact, because it's easy to go from video to pictures, no problem. You can, while it's in video, take a still, which is gonna be better than pulling the still out of the video, because it'll be 5 megapixels on this camera instead of something that's not as clear, okay? So you can do that. So I'm gonna turn it on so you can see what the back looks like. It's very clear and easy to see under the water. My memory's full. But, okay, and then all of the Sea Life, both of the Sea Life cameras, they have the red lens is built into the software on the camera. So before you go diving, you say, it'll say, are you going snorkeling, which it means 20 feet and above, or it'll say, are you going diving, which is kind of 60 feet and above. And then below that, you just turn it to shutter and turn on deep water blue, okay? So that's how you get the sequence of what you want to shoot with. And I'm gonna turn it off right now. And I'm gonna show you, if you're at all interested in this, I'll save you some time of things that I took me a little while to learn. So on the housing is, okay, so what I didn't know right away when I went on my trip was that if you squeeze the housing together, you smoosh the O-ring and it's easier to open. So I was like, I can't open that. You know, something like that. And then once I figured it out, it was so easy. So you just squeeze the housing and open it up, okay? Simple stuff like that. And then this side goes right in here. And then if you're gonna do shutter priority, it has the S right there. And I'm gonna turn this big big circle thing to S so that the camera is doing what the housing says it's doing. So you want them to match up. if you get on your dive and they don't match up, don't give up. I mean, it says on the screen what it's in. So, but it's just nice to be able to adjust it and have it all. And it has this big piano key so you can surf through the menus. You can have a quick jump to with this OK button. I had it at white balance, so I hit the OK button on the housing and it went to white balance and I would mess with it. Because I had one of the older wide angle lenses that I had read somewhere that you had to have it on macro, but that's with your camera. And mine, I didn't need to do that, so I found that out really fast. And then, so on and on. And so with the older lenses and the new ones, we've got these below the tray, okay? So on the tray, the lenses are wet lenses. So if you put it on while you're on the boat, you're gonna have an air bubble in there. So even if you have it on and you roll off the boat or you do giant stride, they hand it down to you, you're gonna have to let water in, or you're gonna take it off the tray here and then click it on, okay? And it's so simple to do that. I mean, the lenses just click on just like this, okay? So now I've got a wide angle lens on there. Also the cold shoe on top, most people have GoPros. So mount your GoPro on the top and then take real pictures with your sea life. So what a lot of people do on the trip is they mount their GoPro on the top and they just hit record for the whole dive. So that way, and I did that one time, the last time I was in Socorro, and I got a mako shark going through like a torpedo that I knew something went by and I was a little bit like wondering what it was. And then when I got to see it on my GoPro, I went, that was a flipping mako cruising past, like a torpedo. So anyways, so we have a girl, you can put anything up here you want. And then how easy this works. There was something I wanted to say about the camera that's really important. It'll come to me. Anyway, so everything breaks down very easily. So you've got, this is 2 2500 lights, okay? So we've got extremely bright lights. 2 2500, so we have 5,000 lumens. And then you can get it down to 50%, 25%, and then off, okay? The blue lights right here are a battery life indicator, so I always knew where my batteries were at. And Sea Life always puts the overpressure relief valve, so we're using lithium batteries, so if there's any off-gassing from those batteries, this is not gonna turn into a bomb. This will off-gas right there. The airlines really like that, by the way. They just want you to carry on your batteries is all. And Sea Life makes it the easiest passable batteries because they're coated and then they have a cap on them and they love that, okay? So your batteries are very easy. So these lights are for the video, but I can pull them in and take pictures with them. We are coming out with a 4500 light for professionals that need to use that much bright light. I think the CRI on that is 96 or 98. I mean, it would light up this whole room. Another thing about our little camera that is probably the most important thing, that little camera is waterproof to 60 feet, okay? Now that doesn't mean they want you to go take it on a dive to 60 feet. What it is if this floods even at 200 feet, it's gonna be in a puddle. You come up, you rinse off your dive, you rinse off your camera and with a little bit of water, push all the buttons, and then you're ready to fix the O-ring and go on another dive. So having the camera be waterproof to 60 feet is huge. If you've ever had cameras flood in your past, it's just a joy. So if you ever get a leak, which housings do leak, if a piece of your hair got on the O-ring or whatever, at 90 feet it can leak, and to know that your camera's gonna be okay, you just dry out everything and go again, it's awesome. Okay, they have these flex connect, which once again, connect super easily to these handles, okay? And you can go use up to 2 flex connects to get the lights away from the lens. So why you want to do that? So you don't get backscatter. Because those lights are so bright and all the particles in the ocean water, the light bounces off it and you'll see all that backscatter if you don't get your lights farther away from the lens. If the light's here and it's hitting little particles in the water, it's gonna reflect back to the light, not to the lens. So that's why you see these guys with their big arms like that. And by the way, if any of you are DSLR users and you have Y joints and ball joints and all that stuff, we have adapters for that, so you can now use all your lights with our Sea Life setup, okay? And then we also have one last thing, I don't wanna take up this whole night, but on our new wide angle lens, which I'm very excited to use, we also have an adapter now. So this adapter clicks on to the front of our housing, and any lens you have up to 67 millimeters will fit on our ring. So we have the adapter, all right? So don't have to get rid of any other lenses that you've been using underwater, which is great. Any more questions? I'm sorry, there's a lot. Yeah.
You don't have a flash, you just use the video lights?
I just use the video lights. On this trip, I brought them just in case something came close enough so I could get more. But our best selling setup for the Sea Life camera is this housing, this tray, these two handles, a light right here, and a flash on this side. So you're starting with both. You've got a light for video and you've got a flash for that. And it's called the Pro Duo. Okay, so it has a flash and a light. And that light that comes with that one also has the sensor right here in the middle of the LED that will dim that light so that your flash is what you're using when you use the flash, so it's all connected.
So you keep the light on.
You keep the light on, you don't have to worry about turning it off when you got a shot. It senses everything. So it's really great. So you can do it however you want. With the 4500 light, you won't need, it's not that much bigger than this, you won't need a flash. You can just have a video light and that on at the same time. It's a little bit bigger and heavier. But this bag is new, and I'm very excited about it because you can fit your whole setup. There's a place for your computer in the back. All my little moisture munchers and all my paperwork and all that stuff is in here. So it fits every single thing that I need on my trip in their new bag. So anyways, these guys know, they've been doing Sea Life at scuba.com for years. They know all about it. So please talk to any of these guys, and if they need to ask me anything, they know how to reach me. Yeah.
The moisture munchers.
Yes.
They turn whatever color is bad.
They turn red.
Yeah,
when they have moisture in them, yeah.
And I kind of gave up using them, so I don't put anything in the camera, and I've never had a problem with it.
Wow, good luck. Yeah, it's a bummer when if it does, because, and do you only go to warm water?
No, I die here too.
Okay.
But I usually use the camera in warm water.
You don't put a little bag, I highly suggest using a moisture muncher, because there's nothing worse than thinking that I'm going to get that tuna and have it fogged up in there, so I would definitely put one in there. You don't. It doesn't have to be them. You can put whatever in there.
They turn color so quickly.
Well, it has. They have a Ziploc on the bag now, so if you just remember to zip it.
Yeah, Ziploc the bag.
I'm sorry to hear that. Okay, so that's my trip. Thank you so much for coming in tonight. It's awesome. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'll see you guys later. We use an app that works with Wi-Fi. You don't need to have Wi-Fi. This Wi-Fi talks to the Wi-Fi in the camera, and you can upload videos and your pictures right there in your hotel room in Cozumel and post them. Okay? Link 123 is the app that we use. Okay? All right, that's it. I'm done.
And if you guys want to check out the camera later, we've got the same camera as well. So you can check out the camera and the lights later. Yeah.
I see you can go diving right off.
Yes, it's true. I know. As long as I'm not having too much fun.
Yeah, anyone want to get food before we go on? Grab some food. But if you guys want to check out, we have the same lights and the same.
Oh yeah, that's the sensor one with the sensor. the new white. See, well, it, I mean, it works.
Really? There's a ton over there.
I know.
Jump out of the water.
That's awesome.
How many megapixels is that camera that you have?
Twenty.
What's the old one? 12?
It was only about this big.
If you have the 1400, I don't know what it was. I'm sorry, it's way before my time.
I believe it's 14 megapixels.
But what's the best about this isn't the megapixel, but the sensor that's inside. It's a really good Sony sensor that shoots raw. And that's huge. The fact that it shoots raw, like she was saying.
Well, yes, that too.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a huge upgrade from any of the previous Sea Life cameras. Because of the, it's a much better camera sensor. Even if you shoot JPEG, which is the default setting. It's a big upgrade. Because I used the previous one, and I used that one. And it's night and day, the image quality.
So, how do they look?
Dave might know better than me, but the thing with most of those other portable or just like generic underwater cameras is they're not really designed for diving. So one of the main things is the white balance is going to be off, and that's one thing that the Sea Life does a really good job of. And the other thing would just be the depth you can take it to. Like, I don't know what that one's rated at.
With a housing.
But, yeah. The
housing. And the red lens is included in the software, so you don't have all this other stuff you have to stick on.
The red lens is included because it was down.
Yeah, it's done in software, so it automatically adjusts for the color difference.
Even at depth, different depth.
Right, you can adjust, you can change it yourself or have it do it automatically, but you don't have to have a separate physical filter on it.
Changing the line of the back scatter thing with my GoPro.
And then the other thing, I don't know if the Canon shoots RAW or not, but the fact that it shoots RAW is a big deal if you want to get serious about your photography and editing. Because the difference, I mean, I'll show some examples here, but the difference with what you can do with RAW is pretty amazing. In terms of fixing the picture later, and adjusting the colors later, and just getting better quality overall. I'm not familiar with the TG5.
What? Olympus.
Oh, the Olympus. Yeah, that's a good one. I've used TG3, which is the previous one.
It's only 12.
Yeah, it's not as high megapixel for sure. It does shoot raw, and it's a pretty fast camera. It's pretty good. Again, it doesn't have as good of white balance adjustments like the red filter that we were talking about. It's missing that. But the cool thing is, with lights like this, it doesn't have to be a Sea Life. Any lights, you can use them with any camera because it's just a constant light. You don't have to worry about it like a strobe sinking cable and all that, because it's just a constant light source.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've gotten to the point where even if you use your other camera with one of these lights,
probably would be good.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
All right, so I'm going to... Everybody get food that wants food? All right, so I'm going to just talk a little bit, just kind of more some general photography tips, specifically related to underwater, but just kind of more generally. Later, Dave's going to show a little bit more like hands-on stuff, and then Daniel Nash over here is going to show some stuff with GoPro. Feel free to interrupt me at any point with questions. I do a lot of photography outside of underwater as well, but regardless of what photography you do, it's really all about the light. You're capturing light, right? And so that presents a challenge when you're underwater because, as we know, you lose light very fast. So there's two things to keep in mind. This is just, in general, a principle to keep in mind, which is like when you double your distance from your light source, whether it's the sun or your own flat or your own artificial light source, when you double your distance, you actually get a quarter of the light. So basically, you lose light really fast as you move away from your subject. So you don't have to memorize anything here, but the basic concept is get your light as close as you can to your subject. Because even if you move from 1 feet to 2 feet away from your subject, you've lost a quarter of your light already. And basically, the less light you have, the worse your picture is going to look, because your camera is going to try to adjust for it by doing a higher ISO. It's going to get grainy, and there's all these other, maybe blurry. And so basically, get as much light as you can. That's one reason these lights are so awesome, because they're simple to use, they're really bright, and you don't have to worry about a flash sinking. And you see exactly what you're going to get because it's a constant light source. And it used to be that basically to get enough light you had to use a strobe, a flash, But the LED lights are getting bright enough now that for most people I would suggest one of these instead. Now they're not quite as bright as a bright strobe light flash, but they're way easier to use because you're constantly seeing what the light's doing. So your camera's already, when you're looking at your camera, you already see what it's going to look like. So another thing which you guys I'm sure already know is you lose color really, really fast when you go underwater or when you're shooting through water. So even starting at 5 feet, you start losing color. Red is the first to go. At 15 feet, you've lost all red. 25 feet, you've lost all orange. So you can see that there. That doesn't just mean depth. That means like distance from your subject. So you could be at 10 feet but shooting something that's 20 feet away and you're still losing all your red. Water just absorbs light a lot a lot quicker than air does. And so that's another reason you really want a light. I mean, I would say like the number one thing to improve your photography, I wouldn't even say upgrade your camera necessarily. I mean, that could help, but if you had to choose one thing, I would say get a bigger, better light and learn how to use it. Because really, it's about the light. So I kind of already talked about this, but like this is a shot that Dave took. This is just with the GoPro, which is not that great of a still camera, honestly. but he had one of these lights. He held it off to the side, and he got an awesome shot just because he had good light. So. The other thing I would say is get closer. And again, I already kind of touched on this, right? You lose light the farther away you are. The closer you are, not only do you have more light, but there's less chance of blur, motion blur, because the farther you are away from something, the more, even if it's the same amount of motion, the perceived motion is more. So the closer you are to something, the less chance you're gonna have blur. I mean, obviously you gotta maintain your buoyancy and all that too, which makes it tricky. But if you were to leave with one thing tonight, I would say get closer to your subject. If you just get, yeah.
So, the closer the better because you get more light, but then the closer your light is, the more backscatter. So is there?
Yeah, that's true. That's why, I don't know if you noticed, her arms were even better than my arms. You can get really long arms. But the farther to the side of your camera that you get your light, the better. Now you can, the cool thing about these is you can actually pop them off and just hold it out, assuming you can hold with one hand and go like that, or if you have somebody to help you. But the best thing to do with the backscatter is shoot have your light from a side. And also side lighting looks better anyway. Like in this previous picture actually, I'm pretty sure it looks to me like, Dave, it was way to the side, like maybe over here coming in.
Yeah, that was, I had a light, like arm fully extended out here holding it.
Yeah, so he was,
and
like, was like
just snapping a bunch of photos and got one that finally came out clear.
So that's what I would say to that, is try to get your light as far to the side of the camera as possible, but still pointed in. I already talked about, I highly recommend, I mean, you can get multiple ones, single ones, you can even use a flashlight, but a lot of times they call these video lights, because for video obviously you need a constant light source, but these are also really good for still photography. And they've gotten to the point where they're so bright that I would say for most people it's better than a strobe. Because with a strobe, I don't know if any of you guys have used a strobe much, but it's like you get it all lined up, you press it, it flashes, and then you have to look at the picture later and you have no idea how much light you were going to get. With these, since it's a constant light source, you're just seeing what you're getting up front. So when I think about like the problem, the number one problem with underwater photography, the thing that I always run into is you end up with blurry photos. And the ultimate solution really is you need a faster shutter speed on your camera. But really what you want to try to do is to make that happen, unless you're shooting in full manual and you really like are advanced and know what you're doing, the easiest thing to do is add more light, have less movement, obviously, and then less distance, which I was talking about before, which is like, because the more distance you have, the more relative the movement is. And then the the last thing would be a higher ISO. The camera will do this automatically for you in most settings, or you can set it yourself. A higher ISO will give you less blur, a faster shutter speed. However, it will give you more grain in the picture. So your picture is going to look not as good. However, in a lot of situations, it's better to have a grainy picture that's not blurry rather than a blurry picture, which you can't really fix. Now, with noise, there are actually programs that will help reduce the noise later that you get from the higher ISO. So usually, that's still better than just a blurry picture to begin with. So I'm going to just show a little bit of editing photos and talk about a couple different apps. And before I do that, like, do any of you guys edit your photos on the computer? Or if you do, what do you use?
I used HDR programs.
Like, oh, okay. Uh-huh.
Which are,
yeah.
Photo mix.
Right. Yeah. Not for underwater stuff, no. Though. Yeah.
Mostly when I'm shooting 35mm.
Yeah, sure, sure. Stuff. Okay. Anybody else done any editing?
Photoshop.
Okay. Yeah. So there's a number of different options. I'm going to show you. I'll start with Lightroom, which is the most advanced option, but I'm more just going to give you some ideas of what you could do. And then after this, I'm going to show you some simpler programs that are even free that you can use. If you want to really get serious, I would say you shoot raw and start using Lightroom and Photoshop. Now, the way that they have it set up is you pay a monthly fee. So for $10 a month, you get access to Lightroom, which is what I'm showing you here, and also Photoshop. So even if you want to try it out, they have a free trial as well, but you could even try it out for a couple months and decide not to do it, which is kind of cool, because Photoshop is generally pretty expensive otherwise. But I just wanted to show you a couple little things real quick. So one thing is, you know, we keep talking about RAW, and I don't know, did any of you guys, do any of you guys shoot RAW? Are you familiar with RAW? Yeah. Okay. So the reason to shoot RAW is because later you have a lot more room to edit the picture. So I'm trying to find a good example here. Let's see. Well, you know what? Let's just start with here. I'm going to show you. On the left is my edited photo, and on the right is how it came out of the camera. Now, you can see I was using a light, which helped a lot. The light was coming in from this side. But obviously, the picture on the left looks better. But I didn't really do that much to edit it. It's not like I did a lot of magic. I'll show you right here. We can do it. Basically, I cropped it and made it brighter and added a vignette. And the basic idea is like your eye is always drawn to what's brightest in a picture. So you want to think about, okay, what's the subject, what's most important in my picture, and make it bright, and make everything else darker. So let me just show you real quick how you would do this. And the thing is, it doesn't really matter so much that you know how to do it in this particular program, because any photo editor will let you do this kind of thing. So the first thing I would do is bring up the crop tool, and I would just crop it down, because a lot of the picture, I didn't follow my own advice here. I didn't get close enough, apparently. Although this is a pretty dangerous octopus, pretty poisonous, so maybe it's good that I didn't get any closer. But so the first thing I would do is I would just zoom in on the subject. That might be a little bit too much. Maybe I would pull this back a little bit. It's nice to get a little bit of the surroundings in your picture as well for context. And I would just do some basic things. The first thing I would do is just make it brighter. So I'm making the whole thing brighter. If you shoot raw, you have a lot, you can move these sliders more without losing quality. I'm going to bring the highlights down a little bit, which still keeps it bright, but it brings back some of the detail, like right here. I'm going to bring the shadows out a little bit like this. So now you can see more like near the eye and right there in the shadows. And these are all very simple. Almost any photo editor will have these sliders. And then another big thing is just saturation or vibrance, which is like how bright the colors are. And if you see the option for vibrance or saturation in whatever app you're using, vibrance is usually the better one to use. Because it tends to be a little bit smarter about how it brightens the colors. So if you see vibrance, use vibrance, slide it up until it looks cool to you. If you don't see vibrance, use saturation. But the other big thing that I did to this photo is just a vignette. And all that does is it darkens the perimeter of the picture. So I'm just gonna slide this here, and you can watch as I slide it over. Just really starts focusing in your eye to the center of the picture. And then if you want to tweak it and adjust it to one side or the other, you can. But just real quick, so like, this was the one I was looking at before. So we're pretty close. I chose to crop it a little bit differently in that one. But just some simple tweaks can take a picture that's okay to make it way better. So any questions so far? Let's see about maybe one more example here. So this was an example. I kind of like this example because, so this is a photo that that Dave took actually, and he shot it in RAW, which means we have a lot of detail to play with. So if you look right here, it's like dark, like as in you don't see anything there, right? So because he shot it in RAW, if all I do is increase the exposure, oh, look at that. There's actually, it's like almost magic, right? Like there's actually stuff in the image you didn't even see. And this is why shooting RAW is so amazing, because if you tried to do this on a JPEG image, you wouldn't get so much detail. And because shooting RAW, it just records more information about the picture. Now, the downside is that the files are going to be a little bit bigger, and you're going to have to use a program like Lightroom or some program that understands RAW. You can't just take the image straight off the camera and just post it on Facebook. But it allows you to fix this picture. So this would be the first thing I would do. But now you notice like this is like way too bright around here. Mm-hmm. So this highlights slider, I'm just going to bring that back down. And actually, that didn't do enough. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to instead bring this back and then keep it about there, but then I'm gonna bring the shadows up, which is another way of doing it. So you can see just like a couple slider adjustments, and it's like a different picture practically. I would probably add another vignette in here. I'd probably just do a little bit of maybe some more vibrance, bring up the colors a bit more. And then there's lots more you could do, but just that, you know, 10 seconds of
And then you can convert this to a JPEG or
a video. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, you can export it to JPEG. So that's the power of shooting RAW. Now, I realize like a lot of you won't be jumping out and getting Lightroom and paying $10 a month. So I was gonna show you some other apps you can use as well that are either free or pretty cheap. So let me switch over to this just to show you guys. And if you guys want, I can send out these links to the via email later. One thing is, if you're using Windows or Mac, there's already a photo editor built into your computer, which does most of what I just showed you. In fact, I know at least the one on the Mac will handle raw images. So I'm not sure about the one on Windows, but so you may already have the program. this VividPix I'm going to show you next. This one's specifically for underwater photos, specifically to help you get better colors in your photos. These two here are, I'm going to show you as well, but these are just online websites. They're free sites. You just load up the website and you can do some simple edits as well.
On those two, do you still maintain the picture or do they get...
Yeah, you get to download it back.
Okay, but it's still your personal
property. I have not read
theirs.
The privacy policies, but I do know that you get the image back again, and I'm pretty sure they don't use it for advertising and things like that. I didn't check into that privacy policy. It's probably good to check. if you're you know, a lot of cameras nowadays have an easy way to transfer your photos over to your phone. One of the best photo editors is called Snapseed. It's available if you have an Android phone or Apple iOS. It's actually Google bought them, so now. I would highly recommend that app. It's really cool. It's really easy to use. Of course, there's plenty of apps for editing photos on your phone. Again, this is the Photoshop and Lightroom $10 a month thing you can get. But let's go ahead and try some of these online editors here. So if you want the very simple list, this is Canva. This is the first one I listed. When you first load it up, all you do is you upload a picture. So this is the picture I uploaded. See, it's pretty dark here. They have very simple adjustment. Then you can go over to filter and you can just choose one of these. And you could just say, I'm done. I mean, that looks pretty good. That's already a lot better. I'll just switch back here just so I can show you this. Adjust here, you can do brightness. It needs to be brighter. I would say it needs some more contrast. And I would say maybe let's add some saturation. Boom, it's way better. So this is free, quick, simple. You can download it as a JPEG afterwards. There's tons of other stuff you can do with it as well. So if you want to go more advanced, but still do an online editor, you can do this one, which has a lot of features. It does have ads if you have the free version running. And there's a couple features it doesn't have unless you pay for it. But there's a lot you can do just with the free version. Way more things than Canva. So like on this one, again, I would probably want to first just adjust the exposure. So let's make it brighter. Let's add some contrast. And I think that's pretty good for there. I would probably go into vibrance here. Let's bring the colors out a bit more. One thing I liked about this one is it has the vignette, which I feel like is always really cool. And it also lets you place it where you want it and maybe like adjust that, and maybe how much you want it to be. It's probably a little extreme, but just a couple quick things like that make a lot. Now there's actually tons of options that you can't see because I need to move the screen over, but you can actually do a lot of crazy stuff in here. There's all sorts of effects, and there's all sorts of fun stuff in here that you can play with. But even just the simple controls like this do a lot. The last little app I'm going to show you is this. Let me move it over so you can see it. This is the VividPix one that I mentioned. This one is specifically for adjusting your colors, specifically for underwater photos. So let's grab a photo here. And
this is the Sea Life one, right?
No, this is not the Sea Life one. This is a different one. They have a free trial. If you buy it, it's like $50.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's try maybe this one. The first thing you do is you just pick which
they kind of give you some options of like how bright you want the picture to be. And I picked this picture specifically because the colors in it are kind of off on the original. You can see the original in here. And then there's just some simple sliders basically for fixing the colors. Now, if you're using a red filter, you've already fixed this, or if you have the white balance setting correctly on your like C-Life camera, you probably won't have this issue, but you'll see this a lot with the GoPro images. But basically, just like some simple sliders to play with to adjust the color and to bring back some of the warmth that you lose when you go underwater. So, and you can just export it as a JPEG. So, I think that's about it. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah?
Typically get a lot of blue and green from GoPro photos. Is there a way to edit that out?
Yeah, so that app that I just showed you is really good for that.
Which one?
The one I just most recently showed you, this one. In fact, I think Nash is going to talk about that a little bit. Are you going to talk about like editing them or not?
No.
Yeah, so this would be a good option, but also in any of these other programs that I showed you, what you would do is you would go to adjust the white balance. So let's see if I can find one like that. Well, here's that same image in Lightroom here. What you would be playing around with would be the temperature and the tint, and generally you would be making it warmer. So like if I slide that over, you can see I'm getting rid of more of the blues, I'm making it more warmer, more yellow. I mess around with the tint too and see what looks good, like maybe something like that. You can even get more advanced and you can adjust colors individually. So you could take blue and you could tweak that color. Right now it's not doing a whole lot because I already kind of fixed it above. But that's basically what you would do. You would mess with the color temperature. So again, that was the previous before I did anything, and that's the adjusted one. Probably also you would, if it were me, I would probably increase the saturation or vibrance as well, and maybe some contrast, because I feel like the GoPro images probably are often lacking in some contrast. Yeah. All right. Next.
So this could like pull out just the red or just the orange or just the green.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. Let me switch over to you. Okay. You can start.
Oh, okay. Alright, so.
Now that they bashed your camera.
Alright. hey, Dan, where's the full screen?
Here, I'll show you. You have to do the down arrow to hit it.
Have any questions on anything before Nash starts talking?
Well, I'm going to be talking about the GoPro. Christine kind of did bash on it a little bit, yeah. But all these photos are actually my photos taken with the GoPro. This is actually in Robotom. So I'm just going to be going over a little bit of the accessories, because that's a huge part about the GoPro, the action camera. There's so many accessories for it that can do different things and additions to like your videos and your photography that you can have. The way that I like to set up my GoPro is actually with the continuous loop feature. So I set it on the highest resolution possible, and I set it to a 5-minute interval. So basically, every 5 minutes, my GoPro will start another video. And then that way I can go back through it and I can pick the videos that I want and delete the videos that I don't want. Like if we're at a safety stop, we're just sitting there, I don't want that video. But I like to set my GoPro and I like to forget it. I don't like to keep going back to it and pressing the button, stuff like that. So the GoPro 4, one of the older versions, actually gives the ability to set the 5-minute interval as well as take photos every 5 seconds. So you have both options there. Go back and look at your photos. And I have the Ocean Quest mask here, which is this one in the top left here. And actually, there's a GoPro attachment that you can put it on top of your mask. And it will sit right there on top of your mask.
Yeah. That's a great attachment. But just make sure that, because I've done it where I push the button and I've counted, like, oh, that. One time I was in board and going down, all these sharks were circling. I took a picture every 5 seconds just to put it on the video.
Oh,
accidentally, and I got almost nothing, and it's really terrible. So.
Yeah, that is the thing about the GoPro, is you have to make sure that it is actually, you have to have your buddy see if it's blinking, or
yeah.
You know, make sure it's recording. Yeah, take your mask off. I personally don't use the mask strap or the mask mount, but it is a nice feature to set it and forget it and get some actually awesome, because it gives you the POV, point of view perception. This tray setup here is made by LumeCube. Each light is 1500 lumens, and it's great for traveling. They're extremely small. It's right here. So you can easily pack it away. It weighs literally nothing. And the 1500 lumens each, extremely bright lights. Here is the switch, I think it's a switch blade by Bulletproof. It does come with a red filter built into it. It doesn't give you the option to remove the filter. So with the GoPro 6, the newest generation of the GoPro, you actually don't necessarily need to use the red filters or different types of filters because it has that software built into it, just like the C-Lite camera, the DC2000. But it does have the macro lens, so you can take this and put it on your GoPro. Right, here's Dave's. Similar, it's not the Bulletpro. But you just,
will that fit on that camera?
This Bulletpro by Switchblade is made for the GoPro 5 and 6.
Okay, so it wouldn't fit on that one, though.
No, but they do make
something like
it's
that.
It's just a different generation of Bulletpro lens, yeah. But with this macro lens, you could take your camera and put it up to your object that you're trying to shoot and be within millimeters, and it'll still be in focus. Another, the wrist mount is great for setting and forgetting. It does have a 360 swivel on it, so you can reach out and turn your camera around and record yourself swimming, your buddies in the background, and it actually makes some good shots, and you can flip around and get what's in front of you also.
So you'd have to have your light on your hand too.
You actually, in all these photos, I don't have a light. This is just from my GoPro.
And did you already edit those? Or those
yes, straight? These are edited with Lightroom, the advanced features, yeah. So like I said earlier, I like to use a video looping setting and forgetting it, the highest resolution possible, and 30 frames a second. The reason why I use 30 frames a second, and this is all for the GoPro 6, by the way. The GoPro 5 and 4 are going to be different settings, and if you have the 4, I have the 4 also. So I can go over the settings also if you want to happen. With the GoPro 6, they added the feature for image stabilization and video stabilization. So if the GoPro 4, you'll get a lot of shaky video. And if you're looking around and you're doing quick movements, it just doesn't come out really great. But the GoPro 6 actually added the stabilization, and videos come out really good with it.
Do you get stabilization at 4K or 30 frames a second?
Yes. If you go up to 60 frames a second at 4K resolution, you do lose the stabilization.
Okay. So you do get the video.
Yeah. At 30 frames, you can get it. And then 1080p goes up to 240 frames a second with stabilization.
With stabilization?
Yeah.
I don't think it has 240 frames a second.
Yeah. I could be wrong, but that'd be 120.
I think it's 120.
Yeah. So all the GoPros up from, I think the 3 has the wireless connection, or 3 and above. You can pull up your phone and connect your GoPro
to it, and it actually displays what is on your GoPro. So not for scuba diving, but it gives you that feature so you can actually go into the gallery on your phone and go through all your videos and drag and drop into what you want on your phone. But you remember, if you're shooting in 4K, it takes up a lot of space, and it'll take a long time to transfer to your phone. And to reduce that transfer time, you can shoot it in 1080p at the higher frames per second. A great app for editing your videos and photos, actually, is Quick Stories. No C in Quick. It automatically will compile all your videos and photos automatically for you. It'll do everything for you, and it'll actually capture the highlights from your videos. And another great thing, this app loves the short interval videos. That's why I like to use the video looping too. Every 5 minutes, I delete the videos I don't like my safety stops or anything like that. And I throw it in this app, and it'll give you a quick little video compilation. You can add titles, it'll add its own video transition, and you can just pick the music that'll go along with your video. And I don't have any of my examples here, but I do have a YouTube link of someone's. So the person who made this video, he just took these videos, gave it to the app, and it added all the transitions and picked the highlights from the dive. Anybody cave diving here, by the way?
Like that attitude? If you happen to have something that you wanted in, because maybe it's the first time you saw something or did something, are you able to edit that into?
Yes, you can actually click where if it's in the intervals, you can go to that video that shows the highlight from, and you can shorten or move whatever clip you want to add.
So you're like, oh, I saw that for the first time, boom, it pops in your Spanish shawl or whatever.
Yep. And Daniel talked about all the video editing, but I kind of ranked it in the skill level. So beginner would be the DivPix, intermediate would be the Snapseed, and then advanced goes into the Lightroom and Photoshop. It just goes into how many options are available and what you're able to do. And actually, this picture of the background, I did take with a DC 2000. This is a DivPix example before and after. With the GoPro, no filter and no light. And these are same dive. This is Rotom. These are just my before and afters using Lightroom. And basically, what I like to do, or what I did in this picture specifically, is I darkened the areas in the background, and I actually changed the color of his skin because it looks blue in the original. And I personally like to take all my photos with the ground, with the bottom of the ocean, and the surface in the image. I think it looks good. This is looking straight up. Our dive master is blowing the bubble rings. I think that's it. Does anybody have any questions about the GoPro? Accessories or editing, like the quick stories? Settings. Awesome. And if anybody has any questions, like going through the settings and setting like the resolution, anything like that, come up to me. I have a couple GoPros. Thank you.
Yeah, feel free to take a break, get more food, use the bathroom, whatever you want to do.
Now, I have zero experience using the GoPro. I've been given a GoPro 4 Plus 2. and then say, oh, I want to grab a single picture and snap it, or do you just take it off of that 5 minute?
With the GoPro 4, mm-hmm. it'll actually take the photos and the video at the same time.
Okay, so it uses up more battery than anything?
Yeah, it will, while it's recording, it'll use up more battery. Does yours have the screen?
Oh yeah, it has a screen.
The screen. And if you can remove it, I actually don't use the screen, because the screen will use up a lot of the battery. Yeah.
Okay. But it's probably better just to go get a 6.
That's gorgeous.
These are all Derek's photos here.
It's still be compatible.
That was off my GoPro.
Really?
Yeah.
The
mm-hmm.
lights, it's just
on and off. Yeah, that one. If you want to scroll to the next one, that was off the GoPro.
Just editing.
Well, not really. Had a light.
Right.
That's the big thing that you had a light.
So this one, I used a light on.
Okay.
And it wasn't anything real powerful. It was just a little 600 lumen light.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it doesn't require too much, but it's just placement, really.
And
yeah, and somebody had mentioned it earlier, probably Nash, but there's macro lenses that you can get for the GoPro. Yeah, and I mean, that's the one I have on mine, but we sell one from Polar Pro, which also works really well. And that's what I was using on a couple of these shots here. But yeah, the sea urchin.
Sorry, I'm just trying to get
a
better position.
Are you doing a lot of body shots
there
here in SoCal? Or are
yeah, so I've only got like one or two shots that are from out of state. Everything else is from either Laguna or Catalina or Santa Barbara, all around there. The white sea anemone, that was underneath a pier in Santa Barbara, and that was off my GoPro as well. And then the snail, the sea lion, the octopus, those were all off my GoPro. And then this one of the imperial nudibranchs, those were off my GoPro as well, but that was out in Hawaii. But I'll get to the rest of that later.
So as soon as I get my buoyancy under control, that's the next thing.
Yeah, and so... what you really need to take good photos, other than just a decent camera, is just technique on your scuba diving skills. And what it comes down to really is just practice. Practicing your buoyancy, your fin kicks, just camera placement, where your lights are at. It really just comes down to all of that. We offer classes on it, the underwater photography class, to teach you all about the different fin kicks, practicing your buoyancy, just different techniques on using the camera.
Oh, cool, they put it on a slideshow.
Some of these are off my GoPro, some of these are off of my Olympus, and a lot of them you'll be able to kind of tell which ones are which. But yeah, so there's all sorts of different techniques you can do. I've taken photos to where I've had to wedge myself underneath a rock because I saw a nudibranch that was like underneath it, almost on the edge of a rock, and I've had to basically get completely upside down and then take a photo of it. One of the things too that comes into play with it is with your kicking. You really want to try to not have to kick up anything, so that's where the buoyancy control comes in too. But it helps if you kind of keep your feet up off the floor, so that way you don't kick up a bunch of sand or debris in the water, and you know, you don't cloud your photo with a bunch of backscatter in it. But a lot of that gets covered in the courses. But so, what I really kind of wanted to talk about is different setups and what you can do to help better yourself with the photography. So if you use a GoPro or like a point and shoot or even a big DSLR camera, or the DC2000 or whatever you have, what really helps is getting lights for it, because as everybody has said, light is one of the most important things you can get for the camera. You lose a lot of it after you get down a few feet, and more so as you get deeper, but when you do set up lights on here, what you really want to do is get them as far away from the camera as possible. And that's why whoever said it, you'll see the professional guys have like 6 foot arms on their cameras with the big strobes out on the end of them. Because the farther away you can put them, it actually creates less backscatter in the photos. And because of that, your photos will come out cleaner. The other thing you want to do too is when you do have them on there, whether it's video lights like what I've got here, or strobes or anything, because they shoot in such a wide angle, whether it's like 80 degrees or 100 degrees or 120, you don't want to put them in front of the lens, because if you start putting them in front of there, the light will actually kind of get refracted into the lens itself, which isn't good. It'll kind of distort the picture a little bit, and not blur it out, but just overexpose it, basically. So you want to keep them back behind the lens. With setups like what I've got here and what Christine was saying earlier, it is really easy to manipulate it, and that's why I like these Sea Life arms. You'll see the guys with the big ball joints or the YS mounts that are on there. And those are a little bit harder to manipulate when you're underwater trying to take photos. These are really easy because you can pop them in and out real quick. You just got to clean them afterwards to make sure they still work properly. I see a couple of you guys brought your cameras. What did everybody end up bringing? I see you've got the DC-2000 there. Or who's this? I don't know whose that is. On a Sea Life camera? Or? Okay. But anyway, so with housings, whether it's one of the Sea Life ones, like what I've got here in Olympus, or a DSLR, or just any other point and shoot, what you really want to make sure of is when you're putting it all together, is basically keeping it in a cool environment, someplace that's not very humid, because if you get humidity into your housing, it'll actually fog up the housing a little bit. It'll kind of blur out your pictures and make them look kind of foggy, which isn't good. It can be fixed, but only so much. So when you do go to install everything into the housing, what you'll want to make sure of is that your O-ring on the housing is nice and clean and free of dirt or hair or sand or anything else like that. So that way it doesn't flood, because the GoPros aren't waterproof. The DC-2000 is, this one is, and there's a couple other point-and-shoot cameras on the market right now that are as well. But you don't want it to flood anyways. So just make sure that it's free of everything you need.
How often should you replace the O-ring?
Only once it starts going flat, or if you start noticing nicks or cuts or any sort of abrasion on it like that.
So it could last 1 year, 2 years, 5 years?
It really depends on how well you take care of it. The first housing I had for a Canon 7D, I had that for probably close to 3 years. I didn't have to change it once. What really helps with it, with whichever housing you've got, is if you leave it open rather than keeping it closed all the time, because that'll actually wear an impression into the O-ring and kind of flatten it out over time. So if you leave it open, or better yet, if you just want to close it up, pop the O-ring off the housing and then just put it inside the housing, so that way you know where it's at all the time, and then just close the housing up. That way you don't ruin the O-ring.
Yeah, just like put it in a plastic bag.
Yeah, or that too. And then one of the other things you do want to check too on them is that the O-ring is like soft too. If the O-ring is like hard and isn't very like stretchy, it's actually time to replace it too at that point. one of the other things that you'll want to do too on occasion is take a little bit of lube on the O-ring, because that'll help keep it stretchy, basically. So once you get that in there, I do recommend, I know it was one of you guys were saying you don't put the desiccants, whatever they're called, in there. Desiccants, thank you. in there. I recommend doing it just because it keeps any humidity from building on the lens in there, on the inside of the housing. So the next thing you want to make sure of is the night before you go out diving, just make sure all your batteries are charged. Because I've had that happen to me before, getting out on the dive and having dead lights or a dead battery in the camera, which would be even worse, and then you don't get any pictures at all. So just make sure of that the night before. I usually go through a little checklist on everything just to make sure I've got everything, you know, charged up, ready to go for the next morning. the other thing you want to make sure of too, if you are running a more expensive camera like a DSLR with a big internal like lens and everything like that, or even on these ones too, make sure the lens cap is off before you go to take pictures, because that's happened to me once and hasn't happened since. The other thing too is a lot of the cameras will be able to do a manual focus or an autofocus. Manual focuses are nice because if you are trying to take a spot on a non-moving subject, you can focus on what you want to focus on with the camera. On moving subjects, autofocus is just easier, unless you really, really know what you're doing, which I don't, but manual focus is good for some situations, but not. But if you can't adjust it outside the housing, just make sure that that's always changed to autofocus. the other thing I wanted to talk about too, more on the subject of lights and strobes, when using the video lights, it does work really well for taking photos. That's what I've shot all of this on. I've never had strobes for my camera. One thing it will do is if the video lights are very, very powerful, and I'm talking like 4,000 or 5,000 lumens plus, when you get in real close on pictures like these, it will actually white out the subject if the camera can't handle it or doesn't have a high enough shutter speed to basically conquer that light. And it'll white out the subject. What you can do on that is you can adjust the settings on some cameras and adjust what's called the EV. What does it stand for again? The
exposure value.
Yes, the exposure value. And you can adjust that down to compensate for the super bright lights. And that's what I've done on a lot of these photos, is I've dropped it down like a third of a stage or a full stage even on some, for when I'm in really, really close, just to get the colors to come out a little bit better. With strobes, they're always gonna be brighter than video lights, but only for like a split second at a time. And I don't know how many lumens they actually pump out, but it's an incredible amount of lumens, and that's when your shutter speed gets kicked in on the camera, because when you have it hooked up and synced, it will detect it and basically accommodate for that. So that's what the strobes are really meant for, just a big burst of light suddenly. What I do also want to talk about too, is if you are diving out in like the Socorros or, you know, the Caribbean, Fiji, anywhere, if you are with other people with cameras, you don't want to be like a photo hog. I've seen it happen before, and there will be some people who will sit there on like a mantis shrimp or something cool that they've seen, and they'll sit there for half an hour taking photos of it. And you're kind of sitting there behind them going, All right, I've gone through half my tank, buddy. I want a photo of it too. Don't be that guy, because nobody wants to be that diver, and it's just common courtesy to other people with cameras to you. You know, you can snap 100 photos and get maybe 2 or 3 good ones, but that's really all you need to, you know, show your buddies and show your friends and everything. So let everybody else, you know, kind of get a turn. let's see here. Does anybody have any questions on anything, or? No? Okay. So I work a lot on macro photography, small stuff, which is what a lot of these pictures are. The GoPro can do really well with it, as long as you practice with it the right way and get what you need for it. Because the GoPro will work well from about a foot away and farther. If you get the macro lenses, like this one here, you can actually go within a couple inches and get pictures of nudibranch like that were up there that are, you know, half an inch to an inch long and have it come out pretty decently. Cameras like the DC2000 or the Micro, have what Christine was calling wet lenses that you can put on the camera to basically adapt to it and get better photos of smaller items. This camera does it internally and has what's called microscope mode and takes really good pictures of small things. Wide angle shots work better with the, I don't have one down here, the dome port or the big glass bulb that was on the front of the camera. Those work really, really well for getting big, nice wide angle views on things. That's about all I had. So, and that just about does it for us talking. Do you guys have any questions on anything we've covered? Or do you guys want to ask about your own cameras?
Yeah, I'll get a GoPro or maybe that little
upgrading there go.
That little one she was showing.
Yeah, it's she's got, I think she had the DC2000 or the Micro 2.0, was one of the two.
It was the DC2000.
It was? Okay. They're fantastic cameras. They're great little point and shoots. The video that's playing on our TV back there is off the Micro 2.0. That is one thing, too, for differences between the GoPro and the Sea Life cameras. Sea Life does a little bit better on the photography side of things, because the GoPros are made to be like an action camera. They're made for video.
Right.
And they do extremely well in video, but they kind of lack a little bit on the picture side. The 6 probably does great. I have never really had my hands on it yet, but Sea Life does better on the photo side. So
I'm more of an action guy.
He likes to set a video the whole dive.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to move that both, then we go the Sea Dragon.
It's the Tough Series. They're TG5. It's their newest one. Yeah, it's a wonderful little camera. We can special order them for you if you want to go that route. The camera itself is like $450, I think, and the housing is $300. So it's about the same price as the DC2000 is. So
you're saying the white balance though is better movement on the Sea Life than it is on the.
Oh, that was the other thing too I wanted to mention. The white balance factors on cameras. the DC2000 has their own system built into the camera. But if you don't have that option, the best thing you can do, especially if you're using video lights, is look up the Kelvin rating that it goes to. It usually says on like the front of them or somewhere on the light of what it's rated to. This one doesn't, of course, but a lot of the Sea Life lights are between like 5,000 and 5,400. So if you set your camera to that rating, your pictures will automatically come out much better as long as the light is close enough to be seen in the photo. So it'll automatically adjust for that light rating and make your pictures come out a lot better. So,
so when you're doing video with the sea light, mm-hmm. do you still have your lights out to the side as far as you can?
Oh yeah, totally. Just because it won't have as much backscatter. Because the moment you take your camera and put a light right here, that light's going to be really bright on everything in front of it. And that's all the little dust particles, all the little sand pebbles, everything. The moment you move it out here, it might get some backscatter in front of the light here, but it won't be shown in the video in front here. So,
how come see like when you're by the Dragon Light, mm-hmm. you only get the short little fixed arm, you don't get...
That's just mm-hmm. the kit they built.
So you could have to buy more.
Yeah, market it on your product. Yeah. Yeah, it's, I mean, that's why you see the professional guys with 8-foot arms on their cameras.
So the strobe can be off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, there are some things you can do. If you get like long extended arms, you can get what they call a focusing light, and just something not very powerful. They're usually like 1,000 or 1,500 lumens to sit right on top of the camera if you're only using strobes. And that will help your camera focus on what you're looking at. And there's some lights that have an auto off feature for the strobe, and it'll detect it when it goes off, and the light will turn off for like a second or two, and then turn back on. It's not necessary that they do that, because the strobes are so powerful, it'll overpower the little focusing light, so you won't get like a hot spot or anything like that in the photo. But that would just be another way to do it too. So.
Yeah, the sea lights, see that.
Their newest one does, the 4500. I think this one actually does it too, mm-hmm. but I don't have a strobe, so. The other option too that you can do with this one here, and Sea Life has one as well. Underwater Kinetics has one too. It's a blue light, and so it's charged. So instead of having a white light, what this is for is it shows fluorescence in the water. It brings a whole entire new type of diving out there, and it's awesome. I've been able to use it like a handful of times so far, but if you're looking at like that anemone picture that I had up here, it was kind of white and green, but if you were to put this on it, yeah, there we go. All of this makes it look super neon, like psychedelic green.
Can you use that light
for this one?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. This one, the yellow filter that goes on the front of it, turns it into a white light.
Okay, got it.
And then when you take it off for fluorescent photography, the blue light will bring out the chemicals basically in the whatever you're shooting, and not everything fluoresces, so you kind of have to like hunt for them and find them. Anemones do a lot of the time. There's some fish that do. There's a few nudibranchs that do as well around here. The Spanish shawls don't, unfortunately. But then what you also need is a yellow filter for the camera, so that way it can view the fluorescence, basically. So.
Oh, okay, so you need both.
Yes, okay. And that's what, on here, that's what this is for. Because this will view the blue light as normal,
okay.
But it'll bring out all the special colors that they put out under that light.
Okay.
So, yeah. But it's really, really cool. And if you like night diving, totally get one of these, because it's amazing. It's a whole different type of dive.
For most of the night diving, or does it work with day as well?
You know, I don't know. I haven't actually tried it in the daytime. It's because the blue light isn't very bright. It's just better off at night.
Fluorescent will usually come at night.
The what, sorry?
The fluorescent, the neon usually comes at night.
It's just easier to see at night.
Yeah.
I haven't actually tried it during the day, so couldn't tell you.
Anything around here?
Oh yeah, all the green anemones out there will fluoresce that I've seen so far. we have, what are they called? The strawberry anemones will do it too. Those ones are real small. Those are usually only half an inch wide or so, but there's a ton of them in one area usually. Those will, there's different types of grass out there that will.
Worms.
Yeah, worms definitely will. There's a couple species of fish that'll do it a little bit.
There's a shark that does it too. I don't know if it's horn shark or one of the sharks around here.
Yeah, I haven't found one yet to try it out on, so I couldn't tell you which one it is. But there's, I don't know if the crabs will either. I haven't actually seen a crab on a night dive and been able to use that yet. But there's all sorts of different animals that will. Even some of the turtles they have found in the Caribbean will do it too. If they've got like the right type of algae growing on their shell, the turtles will start to fluoresce, which is super cool. but yeah. So. Cool. Yeah. Did you guys have any questions on your own gear? I'm curious as to what you got in the box over there.
I have a Sony, the mirrorless, the
D. Okay.
Yeah. The one scroll, I'm planning to expand it, but it's an arm that is it the ball.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool.
I like it so far. I only tried it once.
which mirrorless do you have?
The Sony, the V.
Like the A6?
Yeah.
A-series or the A7? Like A6000 or something?
Yeah, bring it.
Yeah, yeah.
Bring it out here. Check it out.
That's a good camera. I have that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Which housing do you have for it?
I have the
If you're going to do all the videos.
Unless there's a conversion kit.
Yeah, I remember looking at it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you
use
it with,
you
know, one
nut? I have one. Have you been able to use that whole lot yet?
Yeah.
Cool. Because I know you had it on the boat trip, right? When we were up to Catalina.
Huh?
Yeah. No, that's
a
fast
camera.
Yeah.
So what?
Still where are we going? But this one.
Yeah, it just takes some practice.
Yeah,
that's
like
I don't know why. I don't know why, but we've got like three of these little point and shoots.
Yeah,
is it better to just, you know, go into a
somebody see how
that or is it better, easier just to buy a house for the camera that we already own?
What camera do you have?
It's just like a Canon. I would say it's a. I've got a Canon EOS, which is a big, you know,
the one of the DSLRs.
Yeah, but then this one's just like point and shoot. You know, it's like it's about the same size as a Sea Life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's funny because I'd seen the Sea Life on your website forever, but I just was like, I don't get the big deal. It looks like one of these. And, you know, it's about the size of that Sea Life.
Yeah.
And so it's like, you know, now I know why that they're, you know, so expensive relatively.
Yeah.
You know, they're waterproof. And they're,
mm-hmm. But look at how much the housings are going to cost.
Because
for the point and shoots, if they're only a few $100, then sure, go get the housing for it. But for the for your DSLR camera, I can already tell you it's probably going to be anywhere from $900
to $1,700. Yeah. Well, I don't want to take that one anyway. It's too big. And
yeah.
It's just not.
I used to have a Canon 7D. With an off-light housing, a big arm, and a strobe to it.
Yeah.
And the thing weighed 20 pounds.
Yeah. It's
huge, right?
Yeah. The handles were out like this.
Yeah.
With the housing in the middle of it. And the strobe added another 2 feet, at least out this way. And it was, it got phenomenal photos, but it was just too big and bulky to carry around everywhere.
Yeah.
And I would try to carry it down here, like in the
Yeah.
Beach and I would take it on boats every once in a while, but I just got sick of lugging it around.
Travel for the deal. You have to be doing it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was just small enough to fit into a carry-on with me.
Yeah.
But it's like, that's all my carry-on was. It was just my camera and my rig.
You know, it's a good
highlight.
So I don't know if you ever travel. You get in the regular backpack off of Amazon. They have a, to me, for a military backpack, but what I found is that I put my backpack on there. So the 17 pounds, that is, I put my backpack in the backpack, and it's in that, it's a space normally you put your water bladder, and then you can travel with your backpack, so that you don't have to, you know, you have your backpack. Yeah. So that's one, because otherwise I have too much weight on that, when I'm trying to dive, you know, when I go somewhere. So that makes it nice that I can take that with me. You don't have to pay. Because I looked at that, it's about $3,000 over a week.
It's expensive.
Oh, no, but
I don't know.
It's nothing but manta.
So, well, I'm a big manta guy. So.
How deep are the mantas?
I have no idea. I would assume anywhere from 10 feet to 100 feet.
Thank you.
They go. They're whatever depth
of gotcha.
And that's usually the shallower water during the day.
Yes.
So they usually come out to the surface of the
mountain. I mean, you can go to the Chimpros or you can go to Hawaii and do the manta dive there at night for a couple $100. Yeah, but I mean, that's, I'm gonna do a little more so that I can do. Yeah, it's one of the challenges. I'm gonna go just by myself because my wife doesn't like to dive. So it's like, and I've been wanting to go, and she wants to go to Europe, and I'm like, okay, if you go to Europe, she wants to go to Europe with her girlfriend, I'm like, thank God. You go to the Europe, I'm going to go to Mexico for a week. Yeah.
Right now, though, Mexico, yeah. Still living
Just stay out of the stay in the tourist areas, and you're fine. Yeah, it's not really the best time to be in Mexico, but I'm not one day. I don't know. It's different if you were a girl.
I'm
6'4", 2 feet.
Okay, I'm a couple inches and a couple pounds.
I'm honestly aware because they're not going to be also shooting me anyway. And I'm just. It's the situation where those people are caught. They're doing something that they, you know, the people that they're killing are the locals, not the tourists. But the concern there is if they're killing a guy for whatever, a year to get crossfire or something like that.
Well, when they turn around and they take two CDs and go to the apartment and start shooting. Or when they start doing the price bombs on hiding apartment classes or boats. There was two schools of CDs or whatever you call those. They came to each one of the apartments and started shooting. They were not. We have a Canadian tourist who was found floating in the water.
It's one of those things.
Well, being a single female, I might.
Yeah, be single female.
Their newer model is